Welcome students to the online study. We will see the explanation of poem number 3, A Tiger in a Zoo, written and composed by Leslie Norris. Let us see the central idea or the theme of the poem. As the title is clear and vivid, tiger is the theme and central idea of this poem. The tiger is a proud creature. It is a shame that such a powerful, agile and untamable animal should be caged in a zoo. In his natural and wild habitat, he doesn't need help of any kind to hunt its own food. His hunting of deer at the water hole may seem rather cruel, but he hunts not for pleasure but for food. His presence in the natural habitat is necessary to maintain the balance of food chain. So the freedom of such a powerful animal and the conditions in which this powerful animal is kept inside a cage, and then he shows his anger, hatred, even defiance by walking around the cage in extreme anger and pride. Human progress should not be at the cost of destroying the natural habitats of untamable and proud animals like tiger. Let us read the first stanza. He stalks in his vivid stripes the few steps of his cage. On pads of velvet quill, in his quiet rag. Now this stanza express the anger and the proud attitude of tiger. The dweller of the forest is forcefully put inside a cage. The tiger is caged in a zoo where the arrangements are made to accommodate him. And thus, this arrangement is artificial habitat. This is not the natural habitat of tiger. Tiger is a free animal. But by force, man had trapped tiger inside a cage and also made an artificial habitat for this tiger. But what happens? This tiger does not like artificial habitat. This tiger then moves angrily. The stripes on his body are very distinct and can be easily seen. When you see a tiger, the stripes make a distinction. It shows us that what type of animal it is. So by the stripes, we can know that this is a tiger. The stripes are darker in color than the rest of his coat. The stripes are darker than the rest of his coat. The tiger moves very softly and quietly on the pads of velvet. Now see the artificial arrangement that are made inside the cave. Though it is decorated by the pads of velvet, as you know, velvet is very soft. So all the arrangements are done keeping in mind all the convenience should be given to tiger. But he is still not satisfied inside the cage. Still he is longing for freedom, but the range of his movement is limited. See here, even though they have laid down the carpet of velvet, but his range of walking is limited. Up to a certain circumference of area, he can walk. He goes on moving around within the confines of his cage. The area is confined, the area is limited. The tiger has to move in that area alone. The tiger doesn't relish the stares of the people in the zoo. His rage and anger is suppressed. You can see in the first stanza that the tiger, whose description of appearance is given, that his body contained dark stripes, who is forced to live inside a cage that has limited space, and in that confined space he had to walk. But what happens? He has suppressed his anger and rage. Let us read the next stanza. He should be lurking in shadow, sliding through long grass near the water hole where plump deer pass. Now see the condition. When he is inside the cage, everything is supplied to him. The food, the meat, whatever things he would eat, all things are supplied to him. But think about a condition when he was left freely in the jungle, in the forest. What were the activities that he would do? He would lurk in shadow before hunting, before falling upon his prey. He would lurk in shadow, silently. The poet mourns that zoo is not a right place for the tiger. He is the denizen of jungle. His real place is in the wilderness, in the forest. Had he been in the wild, he would have been lurking around in shadow. This is the habit of his hunting. This is the technique of his hunting, that he would hide himself under the shadow, lurking for his prey, looking for an opportunity to hunt the other animal. He must have been sliding quietly through the long grass to ambush his kill. Now the other thing that he will do, he will hide in between the long grass so that he can suddenly attack on the other animal and kill them. He should be using the long grass and shadows as necessary covers to keep his movement undetected. This is the hunting technique of tiger. Whenever he goes for hunting, these two things, the long grasses and shadows, they will help him not to be detected. His move and his attack would be undetected by the animal. He would know where he could get his favorite hunt. Now his favorite hunt, as mentioned in the poem, is the plump deer. Now deer is an animal. So this animal deer is his favorite hunt. So in order to attack, in order to hunt this deer, he would approach the water holes quietly, because this is the place where the deers would come when they feel thirsty. This is the place where the deers would come in order to drink water. In the third stanza, he should be snarling around houses at the jungle edge, baring his white fangs, his claws, terrorizing the village. Now in the third stanza, the writer or the composer speaks about the movement of tiger nearby the village area. Had the tiger been in the forest, sometimes he would stray into human habitation or settlement. Sometimes it may happen that roaming here and there, he comes nearby the human habitation, nearby the village area. And these human settlements are at the jungle's edge. These human settlements are at the edge of the jungle. On seeing the villagers, he would open his long, sharp teeth and claws that terrorize the villagers, that terrorize the people. So such a dreadful and fearful animal is tiger. But it would be just a show of power and strength to the villager. It is just a show that he is powerful. He is dangerous. He would have no intention of killing the villagers and entering their houses. It is just mere to show his power and dread. So, with no intention to kill the people of the village, the poet tried to say that generally, tiger never attack till he is highly provoked. The habit of tiger is mentioned in the poem. The poet tried to say that unless the tiger is provoked, he would never attack anyone. Killing is not his hobby, but it is a necessity of his body. Whenever he hunt, he would have felt hunger. He felt hungry. Therefore, for food, he hunted the animals. In stanza number 3, but he locked in a concrete cell, his strength behind bars, stalking the length of his cage, ignoring the visitors. Now this type of animal who is freely living in the jungle, this type of dangerous and powerful animal, when he is kept inside the cage, what he would be doing, what he will do inside the cage? Unfortunately, he is locked in a concrete cell of a zoo. Concrete cell, that means cemented cell, that is very strong for the tiger to break and escape from the cell. He cannot escape or save himself from the concrete cell, which is so strong. His powerful and strong body is of no use to him as he is put behind the bar. Now, behind the bar, the tiger is kept. It is kept for the visitors. It is kept for the people who come to see the wild animals in the zoo. But here, inside the cage, the tiger cannot use his power. Tiger cannot use his powerful body. His body and his talent or skill of hunting is useless inside the concrete cell. His movements have been limited. Moreover, his movements have been limited. He cannot go and come freely. He cannot move beyond that bars, beyond that concrete cell. His movement is limited and restricted by the impediments. So he can only move around in a cell. His movement is restricted. He is continuously moving about the length and the breadth of the cage. When he is not able to move outside of the cage, he could only move along the length and the breadth of the cage. That means the size of the cage. He can move along with that size of the cage. He doesn't relish the curious stares of the visitors. He doesn't. relish. That means he is not even mindful to the stares of the visitors. Many people who go to the zoo, they look at the tiger. They stare at the tiger with amazement, with wonder. They look at the dreadful tiger, which is so powerful, the teeth of which is so sharp, the face of which is very dreadful, the feet and the claws of which are very dangerous. So they, standing in awe, they look at the tiger, they stare at the tiger. But this tiger could not do anything. This tiger, he ignored the stares of visitors. Why? Because he's inside that cage. Because his actions are limited. His body is restricted by the medium of concrete shell and iron bars. He cannot do anything. So he ignored the stares of the visitor. Now in stanza number 5, he hears the last voice at night, the patrolling cars, and stares with his brilliant eyes at the brilliant stars. Now in the 5th stanza, the poet mentions about the tiger, which hears the last voice at night. The poet describes how the day ends for the tiger. Throughout the day, visitors would come and see this tiger. He could only move around the length and the breadth of the cage. His movements are limited. He cannot go out. He could only ignore the visitors. But what happens in the night? In the night, he doesn't go to sleep till the last hours of the night. He hears the sound of the cars of zoo officials patrolling at night. You know, the security guards or the zoo officials, they keep on patrolling throughout the night so that they could guard all the animals, so that they could see that the animals are safe and entire mechanism of this zoo is safe. Everything is smooth going. So they come to inspect all the animals to see whether everything is all right or not. So in that time, he gets the voice at night. The stars shine brightly in the sky, and so do his brilliant eyes at night. Now see, when this tiger is inside the cage, he could see the stars, blinking stars, shining stars at the night, and his eyes also is brilliant. So do his brilliant eyes at night. If you have watched these type of animals in the night, like cat, dog, tiger, and wild animals, some of the animals, okay? When during night, if we watch their eyes, they are also brilliant. That means they also glow in night. He is constantly looking at brilliant stars. Alas, he watches the brilliant stars only behind the bars of his cage. Now see here, he is looking at the brilliant stars which are blinking, which are shining. His eyes are also shining. They are also brilliant. But he is now inside the cage. He is not allowed to enjoy the natural elements like stars. He is not permitted to go out. He could only watch the stars which are blinking, which are shining so brilliantly, but he cannot do anything. He is inside the cage behind the bar.